first one. It says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, according to the commandment of God our Savior, and Christ Jesus our hope. And so Paul starts his epistle to Timothy the way he starts most of his epistles, by identifying himself and naming himself as an apostle. He doesn't do this in every letter that he writes, but for most of them, he does identify himself first thing, and he calls himself an apostle or sometimes a servant of Christ. He says, an apostle of Christ Jesus, he said, according to the commandment of God our Savior and Christ Jesus our hope. And so this is not something that Paul has taken upon himself. It's by commandment. He reemphasizes this later in the chapter. He didn't, you know, go down to the unemployment office and say, you know, I want to put my name on the book to be an apostle. And we've been studying Galatians in Sunday school, and that's what Paul so far has been spending his time with, is convincing the churches in Galatia that he is a legitimate apostle, even though he didn't spend 3 years with Christ like the rest of them did. Christ did appear to him. He was called to be an apostle, and Christ revealed the gospel to him. Paul didn't learn this. He didn't sit down and study the gospel on his own. He didn't go to Jerusalem to study under Peter or James or John or any of the other apostles. He received what he taught by direct revelation of God. And so Paul's commandment was a commandment of God. And he says, God our Savior and Christ Jesus our hope. You know, and so that's language that we don't see a whole lot, calling God our Savior. You know, most time it's Christ our Savior. Jesus is our Savior because he died on the cross. So has Paul made a mistake here? Has he got confused on his wording?
By calling God our Savior.
God is our Savior. Christ, God, and the Holy Spirit are one. They're separate, but they're one. You know, and God is the one that put the plan of salvation into motion. Christ fulfilled it. And so God is our Savior. And Christ is our hope. And he's our hope because it's through his blood that we receive salvation. He's that hope. The Hebrews writer calls that hope an anchor for our soul. It keeps us. You know, Christ is our hope. That's where our hope is at. That's where our hope is anchored, is in Christ. That's the only reason. Yeah, exactly. So verse 2, he says, unto Timothy, he says, my true child in faith, he says, grace, mercy, peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. And so he's writing this letter to Timothy. It's not to a church, but it's to Timothy. He wrote letters to Titus and to Philemon. And so this is not unusual for Paul. And I think this is part of the reason he goes to the trouble to identify himself the way he does, even though him and Timothy were so close, that he knew that others would be reading this letter. And so he calls Timothy his true child in faith. Paul was not the physical father of Timothy. If you look in verse 18, he says, I committed to thee my child Timothy, and goes on. So twice in one chapter, he refers to Timothy as his child. And it's in the faith. It's through the gospel that he is Paul's child, spiritually speaking, in a sense. And when he calls him my true child, that
the idea of saying my true child in faith is that he is this legitimate wedlock. He's not been converted by false gospel or partial gospel.
He's been converted by
the gospel. So he is a legitimate child,
legitimate Christian. Faith. And so Paul past blessings, he says, grace, mercy, peace, he says, from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, we have comes from God and Christ.
So after Paul, in
the first two verses, identifies himself, identifies who he's addressing the letter to. Verse 3, he jumps right in. He doesn't mince words. He jumps right in to telling Timothy what he needs to know. And so verse 3, he says, as I exhorted thee to tarry at Ephesus when I was going into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge certain men not to teach a different doctrine, neither to give heed to fables and endless genealogies, he says, which minister questionings rather than a dispensation of God, which is in faith. And so Paul starts out, he exhorts Timothy. He encourages him in the way he should go and wants him to tarry at Ephesus. And we know that Paul is very familiar with the church in Ephesus. Do you remember how long he spent? Paul spent in Ephesus. He spent 3 years in Ephesus. You know, and he called for the elders of the church at Ephesus to come meet him when he couldn't get by there to see him, And so, you know, Ephesus was very close to Paul's heart. And we see, if we pay attention, we see a lot of Paul's heart and what type of person, what type of man he was just in this first chapter alone. And so we know that Paul, he loved God, he loved Christ, he loved the church. And so he exhorts Timothy to stay at Ephesus. And this is not, you know, stay a couple of weeks or a couple of days or maybe a month. This is, he's wanting Timothy to stay, know, to kind of put down roots in a manner of speaking. He's not, you know, wanting him to stay there for the rest of his life, but he's wanting him to stay for a good period of time to help the church through these problems that's arising. You know, he says that thou mightest charge, he said, certain men not to teach a different doctrine. He warned them they'd be grievous wolves arise, you know, to rise among them. And, you know, and so these men are, we don't know what they're teaching. We don't exactly what they're teaching. We don't know who they are. Paul doesn't always identify those that he calls out. It was up to his discretion, I guess, as to whether, in a sense, as to whether he wanted to name these people, but he didn't name them. He just says that there's certain men, and he wants Timothy to encourage these men or to charge them not to teach a different doctrine. How much can we change the gospel or the doctrine of the New Testament before it becomes a different doctrine? One word. I mean, it's, you can't change it. If you change it, it automatically, just the least little bit, it automatically becomes a different doctrine. So, you know, these men weren't necessarily teaching something far out in left field, you know. You know, I heard Wesley Simons, a recording of him one time, talking about the way Satan works. You know, he said it's like a baseball team. He says, the devil doesn't care how close you get to home. He said, you can hit triples, you can run, you can get to third base, get men to third base all night. He said, as long as they're thrown out at home, he said, that's all that matters. You know, so you know, the devil don't care how close we get to the gospel. You know, he wants us to stay just one step away from it, just change it just a little bit. It's all he needs. And so he's charging these men not to teach a different different doctrine. If you look in chapter 6, in verse 3, you know, this kind of comes up again. He says, if any man teacheth a different doctrine and consents not to sound words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is puffed up, knowing nothing but doting about questionings and disputes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings. And he goes on from there. And we know that Paul, this is not something that's unfamiliar to him. He's constantly dealing with Judaizing teachers throughout his ministry. Through his missionary journeys, he's chased from town to town at times, you know, because of these Judaizing teachers. And there's even some idea that some of the Gnostic teaching is starting to show its head here. And so he says, charge these men not to teach a different doctrine. Verse 4, he says, neither to give heed to fables and endless genealogies, he says, which minister questionings, rather than a dispensation of God which is in faith. And so, you know, what is a fable? It's the same thing that we would call a myth. There's no historic basis for a fable or a myth, however you want to term it. And so we don't know what these fables or myths were that they were teaching, but apparently they were teaching them. And he says, endless genealogies which minister questionings. And we know how important genealogies were to the Jewish people. And so apparently, they had been incorporating some kind of doctrine or teaching involved that they wove in and out of these genealogies. But what did Paul say? He says they were endless. He said they went on, and they didn't accomplish anything. He says they ministered questionings. And that's what false doctrine does. It causes questions. It's not what the, and we'll see the comparison here, that's not the pure doctrine of Christ. He says they ministered questionings rather, and he makes a comparison here, rather than a dispensation of God, which is in faith. And I think maybe the ESV uses the word stewardship here, if I remember correctly. This idea of dispensation he says these things minister questionings rather than a stewardship of God, which is in faith. And I think that idea here, the way I understand it, is how we as Christians, what is a steward? What is stewardship? What is a steward? That's the same thing. We're to be good stewards, of what we have. Stewardship of the land, stewardship of our funds. It's management. Taking care of what you have. And I think that's the way I understand it. The idea here that Paul's talking about is rather than encouraging a good handling or managing of the gospel or faith, these things minister questionings. In verse 5, he says, but the end of the charge is love out of a pure heart and a good conscience and faith unfeigned. The way I read this, he says, I charge you, he says, I exhort you to tarry. He says, thou mightest charge certain men not to do these things, not to teach these things. And he says, but the end of the charge, is love. It's love out of a pure heart, a good conscience, and a faith unfeigned. So, he's not telling him to do this. Say lording it over him, but as he's a boss or something like that, he's got authority over him. But he's to do this out of love, And where, as Christians, where does our love come from? From each other, or for each other, and for other Christians, and God. John said in 1 John 4, he says, we love because he first loved us. You know, that's where our love should come from. And that's what, you know, the end of the charge is, you know, and that applies to us. You know, if we're trying to correct somebody or teach somebody the truth, you know, it should come from love. It should come from love out of a pure heart. A heart that's not tainted. It should come from a good conscience, and it should come from a faith that is unfeigned. What about a good conscience? Can we always rely on that? It's got to be trained right. Some people, people say, let your conscience be your guide. That might be okay, that might not be okay. It depends on how that conscience was trained, how it was formed. And he's talking about a conscience here that was formed by the Word of God. And a faith unfeigned. This is not a hypocritical faith when he says faith unfeigned. It's someone that's living the way they're supposed to. He says in verse 6, he says, from which things, he says, some having swerved have turned aside unto vain talking. And so what are we seeing here? When somebody swerves, they turn aside, what has happened? You're not staying on point. What do we call that? It's apostasy. When you swerve, off the path, when you take your eyes, off the goal, he said some, he says, from which things, this love out of pure heart, a good conscience, a faith and a faith, he says, from which things some having swerved, they've turned aside unto vain talking, and Wayne Jackson put it kind of, he said, this is palaver with longevity, he said, that amounts to nothing. That's vain talking. It's just, we've all known people that talk all day and never say a word. And and this is the idea. People can sit and talk about stuff all day and never accomplish anything because they just, especially when it comes to religion, not ever say anything. But notice what he says about in verse 7. He says, desiring. These that have swerved, they've turned into vain talking, they're desiring. It's a constant desire to be teachers of the law. He says, though they understand neither what they say nor whereof they confidently affirm. These are people that want to be recognized as clergy. They want the prominence of being someone that teaches, someone has a position, so to speak, and they desire to be teachers of the law. But what's the problem there? And I believe that he's talking about the old law here. He says, but there's a problem. Desiring to be a teacher, is not a bad thing. But he says they understood neither what they say nor whereof they confidently affirm. So they're. This is this vain talking. They don't understand what they're trying to teach. Not really prideful, but it's arrogance. That I think they have here, because they don't know anything, and yet that's bad enough when they're teaching, but yet when they confidently affirm things and they don't know anything, it's arrogance. And y'all get to hear some of these teachers that's coming for this, y'all might think the same thing about me, because we've got some good teachers coming. But he says, that they desire to be teachers of the law. But look at verse 8. He says, but we know, he said, that the law is good if a man use it lawfully. Now again, where did Paul, where does Paul get his knowledge?
He gets his right
from the Holy Spirit. He does. He's inspired. It's revealed to him. You know, and so when he says we know, you know, he knows. He says we know that the law is good. Now if he's talking about the old law, it's been done away with at this point. But the law was good, you know. It's good moral teachings. It's good teachings of how man or how God deals with man. And so, yeah. And you know, and that's the point of the law. That was why it was given. It was to, you know, to usher in the to Christ and the gospel. And so he says the law is good, he says, if a man use it lawfully. Verse 9, he says, is knowing this, that law is not made for righteous man, but for the lawless and unruly. He says, for the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers. And so he says the law is not made for a righteous man. But if you turn over to Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 3 in verse 10, you know, and again, this is Paul. This is inspired Paul. He says, there is none righteous, no, not one. And so Paul says that the law was not made for a righteous man. So who is a righteous man? Who has ever been a righteous man in a literal sense? Christ. There's only been one. You know, and so I think we can understand here that Paul's not talking that the law is not made for a righteous man in a literal sense. You know, in an ideal world where righteousness prevailed, you know, law would not be needed. But righteousness does not prevail in our world. And so a law was needed. And it's for, he says, for the lawless and unruly, for the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane. You know, and this list of people here that he's talking about are people that they know the law, but yet they ignore it. You know, it's people that have no sense of respect for God. You know, they're people that even though they know the law, they ignore it. It's for sinners, those that transgress the law, the unruly, those that will not be ruled. They don't want to be put under the yoke of Christ because they don't want to be under rule. You know, it's made for people that, you know, we've all met these people that if you start talking about religion or a religious topic comes up, you might not even be talking about salvation or anything like that. It might be just a general conversation about religion. You know, and there's some people that just, you know, have no desire to hear that. They have no respect for it. They'll make fun. You know, if you read comments, you know, on the computer sometimes or on the internet, you know, when a topic like that comes up, when you see them one right after another, just people making fun of religion and making fun of people that profess, you know, belief in Christ and things
like that.
Still not face to face, so they've got a little bit more courage.
Yes, exactly. It's like it's enabling people to
thought it, they might, they probably had enough respect, or at least, you know, not to say it, you know, because
25 years ago, who would have thought that somebody could say, okay, you people in Marion County there at South Pittsburgh High School, y'all quit praying because that offends you.
Yeah.
You know, and now, what do? We quit praying because somebody says they were, that's absolutely, who would have thought that?
Yeah. It's, you know, and this is the kind of people that, Paul's talking about here. You know, he talks about murders of mothers and fathers. It's almost like he groups them here. He's, you know, manslayers, people that kill without the authority of God. God does give them authority through government to take life when necessary, but these are just murderers, manslayers. He says for fornicators, for abusers of themselves with men, and of course, he's talking about homosexuality there. And I read that Adam Clark talking about the Greek word for this, for abusers of themselves with men, he said was a word too, I can't remember what I said now, kind of too ugly to speak. You know, of course, this was, 200 years ago, maybe 150, 200 years when he was alive, I guess. You know, it was just such a vile word that he said it was just, you couldn't say it, you know, because of the thought that it brought to your mind. And so he says for men stealers, and this would be kidnappers, people kidnapping to sell people into slavery, you know, liars and false swears. What's the difference between a liar and a false swear? False swear. That's, you know, one of them you're just telling of your own will, but the other one you've actually made a, you know, you've perjured yourself. You went against an oath to tell the truth. And he says, you know, and he don't stop there. He says, and if there be any other thing contrary to the sound doctrine. You know, so that's not a definitive list right there. He you know, he kind of, I hate to say covers himself, but he covers everything else by saying, you know, if there's any other thing that's contrary to sound doctrine. Sound doctrine, what is doctrine? It's teaching, you know. And so sound, the Greek word for sound is where we get our word for hygiene. It's healthful. Healthy teaching is what it is. You know, and so you think about what he's been talking about when he first started in verse 3. You know, he's talking about these men that teach a different doctrine, and fables and his genealogies. What do? They cause questionings. Where was it at? You know, vain, they go into vain talking. And so we see a difference between sound doctrine, which is healthy doctrine, and false doctrine, or a different gospel, which causes spiritual health problems. You know, where the true doctrine will help to heal us spiritually. Verse 12, he says, I thank him that enabled me, even Christ Jesus our Lord, for that he counted me faithful, appointing me to his service. Again, he's, you know, he was commanded of God in Christ, and he says he was appointed to his service. And he starts off in this paragraph here, verses 12 through 17. You know, he kind of bookends them with this prayer of thankfulness. And then again, in verse 17, he has a doxology or a praise of God there in that last verse. And so he's Paul. We see the kind of person that Paul was. You know, we see his concern for the church at Ephesus, and we see his love for God and for Christ. And he says that he thanks him that enabled him, even Christ Jesus our Lord, for that he counted me faithful, appointing me to his service. Verse 13, he says, though I was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, he says, howbeit, he said, I obtained mercy. He says, because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. Did this excuse Paul? It did. We don't have an excuse. But notice he ties it in at the end of verse 13. He says he did it ignorantly, but he did it in unbelief. You know, and so, you know, a person that believes, that has belief, that has faith, you know, they definitely can't claim ignorance for doing the things that Paul did. And so, you know, it's not an excuse, but it's the situation. He did it ignorantly in unbelief. That's the last bill. He says, and the grace of our Lord abounded exceedingly with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. He says, faithful is the saying, and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He says, of whom I am chief. And again, we see a little bit of Paul here. You know, the reason that Christ came into the world was to save sinners. Christ in Luke 19, you know, he says, you know, what did he say? He says, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. That was his purpose for being here. But if you notice Paul's wording, he says, of whom I am chief, you know, and that's present tense. You know, he says he still considers himself that. Paul doesn't take hold of the plow and look back, you know, but it's still fresh on his mind, you know, what he had done to the church and what did Christ say to him on the road to Damascus? He said, why persecutest thou me? You know, but Paul wasn't persecuting Christ. He wasn't physically on earth as he was before. You know, but that shows the church and Christ, how close they are. It's the body of Christ and how personal that is. And Paul said he still considered himself chief. You know, he's seen sinner after sinner, but you know he still remembered the things that he had done. But the things that he had done didn't stop him from working for God, from doing what God wanted him to do. You know, when God told him he wanted him to be, or Christ told him he wanted him to be apostle, he could have said, you know, he said, I've done too much wrong. He said, I've been too bad. I can't do that. You know, and so that it leaves us without an excuse. But we see Paul's heart here in this. Apologize for not finishing. I think that's about everybody. I appreciate your attention and your comments.